is just down I think it's hard to stop the metal part of the wheels.
Yeah, it starts to spark, and I don't think he's going to be able to control that car much longer. And look at that front front bumper there.
It's about to whip right off there as well, but this is one of those more odd pursuits
that we have
watched here on Eyewitness News, because this driver in very tinted windows, so you don't actually know how many people are inside this vehicle.
Yeah, that's the problem too, I think, for officers, is that they don't know how many people are in there, if they're armed, if they're dangerous, if they're, you know, completely intoxicated. It's hard to say, but just to watch this, I think that bumper's going to go off any second now.
Do you see the hand, Ellen, going outside the window?
Okay, there you go.
But are they waving?
Yeah,
they're going to try to give up. Because I would think that it must be really hard to pull over when you're driving on the rims.
You just need to slow down, right?
I don't have any experience of driving on rims, but
please don't, Pauline.
I know. I can't imagine. Maybe someone's trying to get a hold of this person when their family member is saying, just pull over. It's over.
Yeah, and thank goodness it's not on a busy street. You know, as we said, this is kind of in the Palmdale area. And I thought for a second they might be coming to a stop. What a sight that must see of people, you know, on the street wondering what is happening.
Well, they're looking like it's possibly going to the shoulder, Ellen.
Oh,
but
let's hope so.
Just can't figure out if that driver is driving very well. I mean, seems like kind of driving straight for someone who
remarkably
who's suspected of driving under the influence.
There he goes waving again. We're not sure what kind of signal he's sending out, but hopefully it's not.
I don't know. Is it a distress call? Is he saying?
Yeah.
Who knows? You can't tell, but. One would assume he probably has a cell phone, so maybe one of his family members or friends are talking to authorities to give the information that they're hoping to get from this.
I can only imagine how noisy it is in that car as this suspect continues to drive down the road being chased by sheriff's deputies and really knowing that there's nowhere to go. He's not exactly going to be able to evade. There we go. I think he's finally pulling over.
Pulling over, and this is on the Sierra Highway southbound area. So maybe, but then we just saw him turn right there. So, of course, as we know with pursuits, they sort of wind in and out of areas. So trying to keep on top of exactly where they are going.
Oh, and this is a look at the other side of the car, right? Am I?
Yes, there, I think
yeah.
you
so
are.
Those tires are also.
This person, you know where exactly where this person is heading, but you know it would be just so wise for the. Looks like they're pulling over, Ellen.
Oh, thank
I mean, you
goodness.
Can't go in the dirt and expect to. Maybe can go in the dirt and expect to keep on going.
Yeah, just when you think you've seen everything in a pursuit, this person seems to be. Headed somewhere.
And I guess authorities probably, you know, they all have different tactics on what they do during these pursuits, but, you know, trying to do one of those kind of pit maneuvers or something, maybe
exactly.
It's very hard to do with a car that's driving on the rims.
I think our producer just said it's Peaceful Valley Road. And look at all that dust, unless that's smoke. I'm pretty sure it's dust, but who knows?
I think it's...
Yeah, it's just a big mess.
Peaceful Valley Road. Not very peaceful right now.
And you can imagine the desperation this person must be feeling to try to get away under those circumstances.
They can't be thinking clearly.
And here he is sort of kind of tapping on this.
But you don't, you cannot tell, like, are you trying to say something? Like, roll down the, I think this is probably, you know, for law enforcement, you never know if there's anybody inside the vehicle. So you still have to treat it as a sort of a threat because
exactly.
you don't know if somebody's armed and, you know, what they're... frame of mind is, because clearly look at this big old white dog just going two of them going
That's
bonkers
more action than the dog's seen all
yeah
day.
exactly
but you do have to be careful because you don't know if he's armed, you don't know if he's, you know, like you said, Colleen, what state of mind he's in, so they do have to be cautious. And also hopefully there's no other people in that car with that suspect.
Exactly. That's the problem with these pursuits. There's just so many variables. You just never know, and you never know why the person why they didn't pull over originally. If they're suspected of DUI, you're going to still have that DUI
exactly.
when you get pulled over.
And add to that, you know, evading. And obviously those spike strips did their job. But this guy continues to be very...
You know what, Ellen? I think we're going to be talking to somebody with the LA County Sheriff's Department, Sergeant Benjamin Grubb.
Okay.
Grubb, are you on the phone right now, Sergeant?
Yes, ma'am. It's Sergeant Benjamin Grubb from Sheriff's Information Bureau.
It's great to have you with us. Thank you very much for joining us. Tell us, what prompted this pursuit?
Well, what I can tell you is the pursuit started approximately 1448, about 2:48 p.m. in the area of Terra, Subida Avenue, and Avenue S in Palmdale. That's where it was used?
That's where it started. Oh. The freeway and stuff, 1449, and the Cliff Highway.
Okay. Yeah, the deputies believe that the this is a reckless DUI suspect, and it started that approximate area in Palmdale.
So almost an hour ago. So this pursuit has been going on for almost an hour?
It's been going on for quite a while. The speeds, as you can see, are very slow.
All these tires are...
Were you able to do the spike strips? Is that how his tires are blown out?
Yeah, I did confirm with Palmdale Station that the spike strip was used at some point.
Wow. Well, they were clearly successful with that. Obviously, I know you're not going to go into exact tactics, but when you're seeing a car like this going slowly, is it just normal protocol to sort of slowly track the vehicle?
Well, there's several factors to take into account during a pursuit, and one of which is speed. Obviously, the utmost importance for us is the public safety, the safety of the public around during the pursuit. With the pursuit going as slowly as it is, it becomes a very controlled environment. And if a decision is made to keep pursuing the vehicle during a slow pursuit, it can continue.
Well, let me ask you this. Since there are no other people around and there's not a lot of problems with safety, do you ever do the pit maneuver in this type of instance?
Every police department has separate protocols as far as to their pursuit protocols. The sheriff's department doesn't typically enact pit maneuvers as part of our pursuit protocol.
Okay. And then what about, Sergeant, for people who don't really know what it feels like to be driving on rims, I know you do lots of training in different driving situations. I mean, like right now, this car is trying to get up the hill. It's almost as if it's in snow where it can't get traction. So he looks like he's surrendering.
Yeah, I can see he's moving slowly. I'm watching what you're watching. It's difficult. Unfortunately, these cars are very well built, so they can take quite a bit of abuse.
And right now, they are just going to stay guarded behind their doors with their guns drawn. He rolls down his window, then he rolls it back up, and he rolls it down. We're not sure what he's thinking.
What kind of, like right now, for the protocol of the officers there, what is it that they're trying to assess?
Well, there's several things we have to consider, the first of which, most importantly, obviously, is the officer's safety for the deputies on scene. So they're doing what right now they're trying to conduct is what's called a felony traffic stop. So they're going to try to control the rapidly moving, uncertain traffic stop and try to detain the suspect without hopefully anybody being hurt.
We see the officer at the top of the screen with a yellow. Is that a beanbag type of or a taser?
You know, I can't see, ma'am.
Yeah, I couldn't see. Where I'm at. Kind of behind another officer right now.
Mm-hmm.
They all look like they have their guns drawn, though, right now to make sure that they all have sort of taken cover from their vehicles.
Yeah, so they'll try to control the environment right now, and if they can remain static, we can try to bring in negotiators to talk to the suspect if possible.
Yeah, and so, okay, he's rolling down his window again. Hopefully they're going to be able to talk to him and convince him to just step out of the car in normal protocol. Do we know if he's with anybody else in that vehicle?
You know, I don't know if we've been able to confirm if there's another occupant of the vehicle. I know, and I can imagine they're making calls to him to exit the vehicle in a certain manner, in a very controlled way, and giving direct and very specific orders in how to conduct his activities from here on out. I don't know exactly what's being said, but...
But they're probably trying to negotiate to come out and have a safe exit from that vehicle. But you also, obviously, you never know the mindset of a suspect. So I think that's probably trying to predict what that suspect will do is also probably comes into play.
Yeah, that's correct. You know, you never know the mindset, like you said, of the suspect. And it's going to indicate how we respond to his conduct and how he responds to the officer's commands, the deputy's commands.
And Sergeant Grubb, do you know if he was, did he have any reckless driving before or, you know, as far as like accidents during this pursuit? Has he hurt anybody else?
That I don't know at this time, if anybody's been hurt. I just know that that's what kind of suspect the pursuit started as.
Okay, watching some erratic behavior. He kind of put his hand outside of that car window and then put it back in. Now he rolled it back up. So under the influence, I think it's probably hard to reason with someone who is obviously...
Yeah, he looks like he's talking to the deputies right there, L.A. County deputies right there on the scene. He looks like he's trying to talk to the deputies who are all armed, and it can't be very soothing for him to see every gun pointed at his window. But nevertheless, he keeps opening and closing the window, so you can't gauge if he's going to get out or stay in.
Yeah, typically, we don't know if he has a weapon. We don't know what else is in the vehicle. Typically, when the deputies are back behind their car, they're back behind what's called cover to try to keep themselves safe in case a suspect does have a weapon. And usually the deputies will have what's called less lethal weapons as well as lethal weapons pointed his direction to try to handle any kind of threat that might be presented to them if the suspect comes out, if the suspect points a weapon, so that they can deal with that. So they're ready for all those contingency plans on that.
It has to be such a frustrating situation, though, when you have a suspect right here that you know can't get away and yet refuses to give up.
Well, I think ultimately more important than anything else is if we can maintain our time, there's no hurry. We'll try to get a controlled environment and have the safest outcome as possible.
Right. Just takes these resources away from perhaps other things that could be more important.
Correct. Yeah, I understand that, yes.
Yeah, and then, I mean, I guess the suspect, there's no chance that the suspect's going to try to probably take off. He's just kind of barricading himself in there because those rims, they can't get traction, so he's just... I mean, this could last for hours, correct?
Yeah, it's hard to guess what the outcome will be. I know there's additional resources they can call. We have a special enforcement bureau that specializes in barricaded suspect. So if this thing continues for too much longer, they can do what's called, they can bring out specialized teams to try to mitigate this threat. Special crisis coordinators, crisis negotiators that can come try to talk to the suspect. There's many different avenues and different resources that I'm sure are on the way to try to deal with the suspect.
And are some of these officers trained in negotiating with suspects like this?
They are. There's different levels. Every deputy has their own specialties. There's different training that that each and every deputy can receive that's available to them. So different deputies have specializations in different areas. But there are a special crisis negotiator that are more specifically trained for that, and I'm sure those are responding now.
Yeah, absolutely. I know we've spoken to Sheriff McDonald and has talked about how mental health specialized deputies are also going to be getting involved in mental health as well, because clearly not only is this person a suspected DUI, but mental health has to play somewhat of a role in this, why the person is not getting out of the vehicle and surrendering.
Yeah, I can't speculate. I don't know what the mind frame of the suspect is, but I would hope that he would eventually step out and have a peaceful resolution and respond to the deputy's request.
Because right now it's just a matter of waiting. I mean, the time is on these deputies' side, so it's just a matter of waiting this guy. Oh, I think he's put his hands up.
It looked like two hands went out. Yeah, you're right,
Let's
Alan.
Let's hope he is surrendering. That would be nice.
Maybe he's trying. Who knows? Looks like it as we
I think he's trying to
he threw something out. Isn't oh no, I don't know.
Maybe he had to throw his keys out.
Sometimes they have to do that.
Yeah.
But I know Sergeant Grubb, every you know, law enforcement agency has their own way of handling a situation like this. But would that be something that you would ask the suspect to do, to throw their keys out of the vehicle before they even open the door?
It could be. There's several different methods to getting the suspect to surrender safely. One of them could be might have ordered the suspect to drop his keys out, and if that's the case, that's a good sign.
Right. Let's hope that's what he was doing. But then again, he did roll up his window again, so it's a little absurd.
Also, how many sort of charges could one face just by this situation?
I don't know all the totality of all the charges. There's several things that certainly reckless driving, and I don't know what other things occurred prior to us getting on camera here, but the speeding, the reckless driving, and the putting public in danger, all those things can be taken into account when they decide to file charges based on what occurred.
Yeah, well, while we're waiting for the suspect to come out of his car, I always thought it would be a good idea for every minute they make us wait, that their sentence should be a little bit longer. Maybe it'd be an incentive for them to give up sooner.
You'd be a tough judge, Ellen.
Hey, bud, JT's actually not here today. Oh, is that AR-5 that dropped off those troops, or what? Hey, Christina, go ahead. Yeah, yeah. We can go to Fox Field, but we have quite a bit of fuel. What do we have, like an hour and 40? Hour 30? Yeah, we have about an hour and a half, maybe a little bit more. But Fox Field is a lot closer than Van Nuys. Yeah, yeah, Fox Field's good, and I heard AR-5 is going back to get the fur missiles, the dogs. No problem. Oh, nice. Yeah, let me look for it here. Yeah, what do you got? Okay. 482-8125. Okay, thank you. I gotta find it. Trying to hold this shot with one hand and you operate the scanner. Not easy. Yeah, there we go. The fueling is probably going to be, I would say, 30 minutes round trip, maybe 35 minutes with a quick turn-ish. It's about a 10-minute flight there, 10-minute flight back, and 10 minutes to get fuel. Yeah. Yeah, you want us to be for the top of the six is the goal, right? Yep. Okay. Oh, no, yeah. You gotta prepare, you know? 10-4, 1 minute. Okay, sounds good. And I think they might be using less than lethal rounds on this guy soon, I'm kind of hearing. And they got the fur missiles in here. Yeah, the dogs. Fur missiles, they call them. Dark down there. 10-4, 1 minute out for 20 seconds. Oh, yeah. Got the launcher. I'm not sure. Yeah, that's a grenade launcher, but I'm sure they're shooting tear gas or something. And just so you know, I think we're alone. 9 and 4 went to get fuel, so if this ends now, it'll be exclusive. Here we go.
Thank you.